Man, this game is so good.
Yeah, it's okay. Not as good as FNAF. Sure.
Yeah, right. FNAF's a kid's game, dude.
What? It's not for kids, all right? Look, it's the best thing since freaking Jupiter and Venus, all right?
Dude, you're talking absolute nonsense. Plus, that game isn't even scary.
No. Also, have you even played FNAF?
No, but I don't need to know it's bad.
You've never played FNAF?
Dude, you've never played Five Nights at Freddy's?
You've never played FNAF?
It's got one of the best jump scares with them damn anime.
Dude, this game, imagine!
No, you see, Five Nights at Freddy's in Scott Cawthon is comparable to Jesus Christ himself! FNAF should be hung beside
Jesus
the Mona
Christ,
Lisa. It is
coming.
Literally
come down.
The most exciting game ever.
FNAF is so good, I want the game to, like, become, like, a physical CD so I can, like, shove it out.
Batman! What happened? Are you okay?
He slimed me.
Horror is my absolute favorite genre in any media, including video games. Now, I've played my fair share of horror games. We got Outlast, we got Alien Isolation, I mean, I've had my fair share of rodeos. But I have a horrible confession, guys. I've never played Five Nights at Freddy's. I mean, I have, but I played the first and second game, like, once around the time they came out, which means I was a child back then. I was a kid. So I pretty much have no memory of these games, other than that they were like a pretty big deal to my friends and that they scared me. This might sound unbelievable to you guys, but I truly don't know jack diddly squat about anything when it comes to FNAF. I've seen some memes on Instagram, I know a guy killed kids and put them in animatronics, but like, that's all I know, really. When I spoke to a friend who, coincidentally, is a fan of FNAF about making a FNAF video and how little I knew, he actually got upset thinking I was joking. As funny as his reaction was to me, it sort of sat with me. His reaction to my obliviousness was such a curious thing to me, and it made me decide to sit down with a couple of friends asking why FNAF was such a big deal. I needed to know because I felt almost at a loss on why this franchise captured so many people.
I definitely wouldn't be, I wrote a letter to Scott Cawthon like a year ago, around when the whole Twitter thing happened, and I said something similar where it was like, because Scott does read his fan mail, but like, I wrote something similar about how I definitely wouldn't be the same person I am today without FNAF.
Well, I found it when I was like pretty young. I think I was like 9 when I got into it. And like, I actually made 2 friends off of it, like one time like at recess in like grade 4 when I was like 10. I met like my friend and because they both liked FNAF, and we used to like sit at the back of recess and like play or like role play Five Nights at Freddy's for some reason. That was kind of the beginning of it.
It was just super exciting, like as a kid, seeing every new teaser on his website. I remember this one memory of, I used to have like this one friend who kind of knew FNAF, and I didn't really have anybody else to talk to it about, but I remember rushing home from school after my friend told me about like a new teaser or whatever, and I went on Scott Games website, and it linked to his YouTube channel, and it was the FNAF 3 trailer, and I was so hyped.
But yeah, ultimately I developed like 2 of my biggest hobbies off of Five Nights at Freddy's, drawing and writing. I mean, like, I want to pursue writing as a career. I want to become like an English teacher now. And I don't know if that would have been possible without Five Nights at Freddy's like helping me learn how much like or discover that I really like writing and drawing as much as I do now. It also got me into video games.
Now, if you ask me how I feel about FNAF now, then you're gonna get like a 2-hour long answer.
But today, I put my foot down. Today is the day I stop looking from the outside in. Today is the day I play FNAF and see what all the rave is about. I want to learn the lore, I want to play the games, and I want to suck this franchise dry. Today is the day I start conquering FNAF. Yep, this looks like the place. Not exactly what I had in mind, but this can work. Showtime, baby. So, I played FNAF. This is the game that started it all. And you know what? I get it. I walked into this game thinking it was going to be a bit of a snooze fest, in all honesty. I thought I wouldn't understand what the hype was about since I was coming into this so late, but fuck, FNAF was good. Not only good, but I thought it was downright spectacular. I'm assuming most people know the gameplay of FNAF. We have to manage a limited supply of power, monitoring cams, closing doors, checking lights, all while the ghoulish animatronics are trying to break into our office and kill us. With all the elements that have been carefully crafted, this relatively simple gameplay loop is given incredible depth. Visually, I thought FNAF was absolutely stellar. I know FNAF was out long before the whole backrooms trend, but every single room in this building felt off. Somehow, the walls themselves were hosting an uncanny valley sensation, and they were screaming at me to look away, but I couldn't. FNAF's aesthetic sang to me like a siren song, luring me into danger I couldn't even begin to wrap my head around.
Uh-oh.
I'm tossing around all this praise I feel for FNAF's visuals, and I haven't even begun to talk about this game's claim to fame.
Holy fuck! I'm coming!
The animatronics. From my understanding, FNAF was created by one man, Scott Cawthon. And you're telling me one guy is responsible for these designs. You can send all the hate mail you want, but the animatronics in FNAF have such incredible designs that, honest to God, I think they stand up to, or even surpass, other horror icons like Jason Voorhees and Michael Myers. Maybe it's just the fatigue I feel for the generic lumbering serial killer waving around a knife, but these animatronics are such a breath of fresh air. They're so delightfully eerie, and it boggles my mind that one man is responsible for their creation. Every time I spotted an animatronic on a camera, the hair on the back of my neck raised. As killer as I thought FNAF's visuals were, though, I thought another one of its elements was much stronger. Its sound design.
The fuck are you doing in my room?
Five Nights at Freddy's has got some scary noises, you know? The pizzeria is filled with all sorts of harmless noises, such as children's music, charming little hums echoing from Pirate's Cove. These sounds on paper should be friendly chimes with no other sinister motive, but instead juxtapose with the terrible situation we find ourselves in. The sounds are wrong and unsettling. In horror, sound is very important. Sound is a tool used by creative minds to set tones, feed us information, or even to deceive us. Sound is so important in horror media that I'd even argue it is much more important than the visuals unfolding before us. Even if we cannot see Freddy, we can hear Freddy. And that scares me. And I'd like to think it scares the player too.
What? Are you serious?
Hearing something without seeing something can strike fear in ways visuals can never hope to achieve. Now, listen to this sound. What could be responsible for this noise? A serial killer? Hiding behind the door? A vicious, bloodthirsty monster? Or is it something else entirely? Whatever is responsible for this sound inevitably doesn't matter, because what makes this sound scary is our lack of knowledge on what is responsible. In both film and video games, I cannot find an example that takes sound as serious as FNAF. FNAF feeds the player a lot of sound, so much so that some players could definitely find it overwhelming. Office fan humming, electric static from cameras, kitchen utensils clattering. In the beginning, this all will seem like an orchestra of noise serving nothing but to feed into the pizzeria's atmosphere. But as the player progresses from night to night, we begin to learn what sounds are there to muddy your information and what sounds are there to help. Hearing Freddy laugh for the first time starts as a, "Oh, that was creepy," response from the player. But as we monitor our cameras and watch Freddy's movement across the pizzeria, we can begin to tie his movements to his laugh. Each laugh signaling Freddy's crawl to your office. This trick is repeated with other noises, like the footsteps from beyond our office doors, and the slamming of pots and pans. The puzzle FNAF creates is which sound matters and which sound doesn't. This, and all of the other diverging elements the game throws at you, makes FNAF's sound design remarkably stressful.
Thank you all for helping me decide that. Really,
you didn't even get the long, like, silence.
Am I just dead?
Okay, you're dead. You're dead. Were you on 4 a.m.?
Am I just? There's nothing I can do.
Nope.
No. You. Oh, you got the short song. Poor
yeah,
guy.
You're dead.
Oh, it's shut. What the heck?
I don't know what it is, but there's something about FNAF and its lore that just itches my brain. Maybe this was because of FNAF's strong internet presence. Or maybe it was how much my friends hyped this up to me.
Man, you're gonna love Five Nights at Freddy's.
I don't know, man. I don't really think it's my thing.
What do you mean, not your thing? It is the most beautiful, elegant story ever crafted.
Yeah, but isn't it just a kid's game?
But all of the gameplay, the visuals, sound design, etc., it was all in the background for me. I, just like everyone else, was captured by the lore. Now, I knew FNAF was cryptic about its story and kept its details under a thick layer of mystery. Before I played Five Nights at Freddy's, I criticized its storytelling. I used to say that it was lazy and it was a way of hiding a lack of creativity. Let the fans or people interested fill in the gaps of whatever the creator was trying to say. And maybe there's a level of truth to what I'm saying, but if I were to say it wasn't effective, I'd just be lying. The small bits and pieces given to me from phone calls and newspapers made me feel like some sort of amateur detective or conspiracy theorist. I imagine this is what brought together such a strong community.
I'm pretty sure the phone guy is the purple guy.
I know it would be impossible to understand the overarching story without playing the rest of the games, but I need to try and break down what I absorbed. For hardcore FNAF fans, this might be really difficult to listen to, but I'm gonna just attempt to tell the story on how I see it so far. Now, first things first. After spending 5 or 6 horrible nights at Freddy Fazbear's Pizzeria, I am still left with a lot of questions. So, firstly, the big question on everyone's mind is why on earth are these animatronics trying to kill us? Now, the phone guy says the animatronics act a little quirky at night, and they roam around. He explains that when the animatronics find you, they'll mistake you for an endoskeleton and attempt to put you into a suit. Now, there is no conceivable way that I'm going to believe this. I just cannot imagine a company making features so dangerous. Throughout the game, FNAF contains information of the disappearance of 5 children who were last seen at Freddy Fazbear's. Newspaper articles detailed how a man lured the children away and murdered them. These children were most definitely stuffed away inside of the animatronics. Other newspapers say complaints of a foul odor and liquids leaking from the animatronics. A parent even described them as reanimated carcasses, which is pretty on the nose. So that about sums it up. 5 kids were stuffed away in suits, and now the 4 animatronics are haunting the pizzeria. But what about the extra child? There's an extra child! What about the extra child? The phone guy makes references to an incident he calls the Bite of 87. Seemingly, a child was bitten by an animatronic, causing severe injury or even death. Coincidentally, when typing 1987 in the custom night mode, we get this jolly jump scare.
1987.
Why'd you go down like that? That was stupid.
I thought it went up to 10.
Alright, do it.
19.
Ready.
Is this supposed to be like the bite of like 1987?
No,
yeah, you unlocked the really hard mode.
What the? Thank you to my friend who told me to do that, by the way. Thank you. That was awesome.
You stupid
So, before I played FNAF, I was already aware that there was such thing as a Golden Freddy. Now, Golden Freddy's appearance when typing 1987 leads me to believe that Golden Freddy is the culprit of the Bite of 87.
I know one of you guys bit that kid. And listen, as soon as I figure out who it was, I'm going to shoot them dead. Okay. So, none of you guys are gonna fess up? Alright. I'm gonna figure it out anyways, and when I do, I'll make sure it's painful. You! It was you, wasn't it?
Please! 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 I'm begging you! Please don't kill me! Please! 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 I'm begging for my life here! Please don't kill me!
This also explains to me why Golden Freddy isn't present, as they removed him from the cast due to the incident. I also reviewed clips of Golden Freddy appearing in people's offices, and he is definitely a lot different compared to the other animatronics. Golden Freddy seems limp and hollow, much more akin to a suit. So does that make Golden Freddy a suit and not an animatronic? But if Golden Freddy's a suit and not an animatronic, then how could he be responsible for the Bite of 87? How can he even move in the first place if he's not an animatronic? And if he wasn't responsible for the Bite of 87, then who else could it be? Was it Foxy? I mean, Foxy's out of order. And realistically, why do we keep coming back to work knowing these animatronics are out to kill us? And why do they even want to kill us? It's too much. I just had some sort of expert. I don't know. Finally, I can get the fuck out of here! Step aside, bunny boy. Employees only. Now, I gotta see this.
Oh. It's just the old storage room. Oh, what's in here?
What the hell is that? Holy crap! Where the hell am I?
Sit the hell down!
Jesus! What the hell happened? And who are you?
The name's Professor Snugglebottom, and I heard you needed an expert.
An expert? You mean on FNAF?
Well, that's what my PhD's in. Now I heard that little theory of yours, and I have a few bones to pick with it.
My theory? What's wrong with my theory?
It's wrong is what it is!
Okay, jeez. Then what the hell happened?
Well, you don't know because you're a goddamn knucklehead.
Okay, then what the hell was going on with the animatronics? Why'd they even want to kill me?
I can't tell you that just yet. You're only at the start of your journey.
Journey? I just wanted to make a video about a horror game.
Well, you're knee-deep in it now, boy. Now listen up, because I'll only say it once. Well, if you haven't figured it out yourself, 5 kids were lured into the back room, slaughtered, gutted, and strung up.
Well, that was morbid.
Well, if you think that's messed up, to clear it all up, those kids were stuffed, God bless them, inside those godforsaken suits. And you all know what happened.
What happened?
Well, those damn things are haunted.
Is that why there were complaints the animatronics smelt? And who the hell was Golden Freddy? And what about the Bite of 87?
I can't answer that yet. We've spoken long enough, you and I. Now listen, you seem like a good man, and I wish you luck. But I've seen a lot of people walk this path and never come back. But you seem different. Now put her there!
Am I ever gonna see you again?
You'll be seeing a lot more of me.
Not this shit again. Well, this place got a hell of a lot bigger. That's fucking annoying. I told you, that was fucking annoying! Yeah, no, I'm good. I don't want that. Ooh! Seems we've upgraded to something a bit more high class. Where are the doors? Where are the doors?! Where are the doors?! FNAF 1 had elegantly handcrafted visuals, perfectly eerie, and always instilled a feeling of being off to the player. The entire pizzeria itself felt haunted alongside the animatronics, being such an essential element to its horror. FNAF's first sequel, for me, took a different direction. The new location had lost its uncanny valley feeling that was applied to its walls, rather replacing it with something else entirely. This time around, we are given something new, a different take and feel on how FNAF's settings can be scary. Its layout is a grand open space, leaving so much room for the animatronics to play in. The new pizzeria turns around from FNAF 1's tight and creepy layout and mirrors the look of an empty mall or school building at night. You feel like this place is supposed to be bustling with people, but it's not. Just another reminder that we are completely alone and nobody is coming to help. The fact that we can't see all of this building's details, even with the help of the flashlight, breathes new life as its mysterious charm begs you to investigate what lies behind its walls. But we can't. We're trapped in one solitary room.
Guys, look!
New office.
It's pretty! Let's catch it!
FNAF 2 changed the wheel in what we thought an office could look like. FNAF 1 cushioned us with 2 massive metal doors that we could slam on the animatronic's face, keeping us away from danger. Even if that sense of safety was temporary and fleeting, it was still comforting.
This is my own private domicile and I will not be harassed! bitch!
I was plopped into FNAF 2's office and was greeted by one thing, a massive, gaping hole in the wall that I could do nothing about. As the night proceeds, this doorway has turned itself into a manifestation of inevitability. Anything that stood in between its frame was a portrait of my potential killers. I couldn't be comforted by a wall between the animatronics and I. Only a flashlight and a mask to face them like the man I was not prepared to be.
Hi there!
Not only was there a gaping hole in my wall, but on my left and right were open vents acting as a highway to my office. I have never felt so vulnerable, and the only shield we were given to hide behind was a flimsy mask, hiding in plain sight. FNAF 2 paints a different interpretation on what makes the animatronic scary. The first game made my skin crawl with how astonishingly ominous their designs were. They tapped into such a primal fear of ours by hitting the sweet spot of the uncanny valley's depths. While FNAF 2 still holds this feeling with a handful of its designs, I don't like this one. What really broke me into a sensation of anxiety is how truly massive these things are.
Everything is eating me up! What is that?
Hold up your monitor, right. You.
What? FNAF 2 sets a phenomenal sense of scale, building up the animatronics to be these broken giants still walking among us. They tower over the player, seriously reinforcing the horror that these tragic monsters pose. I never thought a game like Five Nights at Freddy's would be replacing the emotions I felt when playing games like Shadow of the Colossus, placing me in life or death situations with these impossibly gigantic forces of nature. Yet, I still felt so much sympathy for them. Behind the exterior, although ghastly to look at, these are still children. Angry, angry children. The animatronics stood before me as a reminder of why I was playing through this franchise.
I didn't even realize-
The agony,
what?
Despair,
no!
And terror. FNAF 2's animatronic design is impossibly perfect, and as of now, it is easily the best. But we still have so many more games to go. FNAF 2's sound design was a sonic roller coaster of comedy and misery. When an animatronic first made its grand entrance into my hallway, the game played its infamous ambient noise. As nicely as I thought this fit into the game's setting and how useful I found it, FNAF 2 ambient noise tutorial.
Leave it on for as long as you want. Eventually anything that wandered in will wander back home. Someone used one of the suits. We had a spare in the back.
I could not help but just laugh after what the internet has done to it. FNAF 1 was using audio as a medium to supply the player with a puzzle to solve, some sounds being warning signs and messages, while others were muddying our head with stress and fear. FNAF 2 opts to remove the puzzle FNAF 1 made. Every sound serves a purpose. Static from cams or your room, mangle. The sounds of something shuffling around in the vent, you can bet something is in there. A child's laugh. Balloon Boy is on the prowl. You get the picture. No piece of audio is accidental. Everything is a carefully crafted warning screaming for your attention. This time, there were no questions of, what was that? As the answer will always be right in front of us. FNAF 1 demanded me to make every decision with the sacrifice of power. It was a tense game of survival and had my heart stressing with its bone-chilling setting. FNAF 2 is what I'd imagine working as a line cook would be like. Everything is happening all at once, and there's so much of it. I'm getting plastered by a million tasks all at once, and every single animatronic is jumping on top of my balls with glee. Please, let me go! When FNAF 1 was asking me to sacrifice my power, FNAF 2 was asking me to sacrifice my time. Alongside this, a ticking time bomb was placed onto my lap, and I was asked to fend off tons of animatronics at the same time. Every moment, I'd be shoving things out of my vents and halls, but the music box always demanded my attention.
Yeah, go fuck yourself, you puppet prick.
I really loved FNAF 1's gameplay. It demanded me to be smart and think on my feet, and FNAF 2 took it two steps further, and eventually, it made the whole cycle way more exhausting. It wasn't anywhere near as difficult as FNAF 1 in my opinion, but it definitely got way more annoying and frustrating.
Get the fuck out of here!
Get her! Get her! The animatronics were so abundant and in my face that after night 2, I simply wasn't scared of them anymore. And that is this game's biggest crime. Taking these incredible designs and numbing the fear I felt towards them.
Here's an original joke. My dick in your butt.
Oh!
Bye-bye. Good night.
Bye.
Scott served us the new faces of horror on a silver platter, but in return, he asked us to play two games of Octodad at once, and also put a finger in our ass. If a horror game isn't scary, is it really succeeding in what it's trying to do?
Vent, light, camera, light, shit!
Alright, I gotta get the fuck out of here.
Holy shit!
Oh, damn. Poor bastard.
Please let me out of the door! They're coming, quick! Please!
Oh god, oh god, oh god!
Where the hell am I?
Traveler.
Meet again? Sorry, who are you?
I don't remember you. It's alright, I thought we had kind of a good little convo last time. It's all good though, don't worry about it.
We've met? Wait, Snugglebottom?
Yep. It's a little old me.
You look so different.
I don't really care, I don't understand what you're talking about, but okay.
What do you mean? I mean, you look completely different. You even sound-
No. Now, you probably have a lot more questions, a lot of crazy little questions. Love to enlighten you, my dear. But, you just tell me, because I'll fucking answer them, I guess.
Yeah, I'm just so confused. I feel like I'm more lost than ever. I just don't know what's happening.
Fear not, or I will tell you all I can share.
Wait. Let me get this straight. We've got four restaurants. Fredbear's Family Diner, a 1985 Freddy Fazbear's Pizza location, the FNAF 2 new and improved restaurant, and finally, the FNAF 1 location. So, at the 1985 building, an innocent young girl was the victim of the purple guy's vicious slaying. Her poor soul went on to haunt that horrible, horrible puppet. Even more children were slain by the purple guy in his wild and deranged killings. The puppet gave them new life, placing the children's bodies into the animatronics in an effort to get revenge. After the missing children's incident, the 1985 building was forced to close. 2 years later, the new and improved Freddy Fazbear's Pizza is opened with the new toy animatronics. These animatronics are a lot more advanced than the previous ones, with a criminal database system to detect predators in an effort for no kid to go missing ever again. It only took a few short weeks for the restaurant to close again after an animatronic bites the frontal lobe out of a poor victim. This was most likely Jeremy Fitzgerald as he worked his first day shift. Years later, in 1993, the FNAF 1 Freddy Fazbear's Pizza opened its doors to the public. To help prevent another accident from occurring, the animatronics are no longer allowed to walk around during the day. But with the horrid odor and haunting accidents that loom over the Freddy's brand, the building was shut down and left to rot later that year. Dude, hold the phone. I have a lot more questions. You can't just leave me dry like this. I have to—
Shut up! Good luck, my little kerosene princess.
Please, please, please let me out. Please, not again. Fine. Maybe this won't be so bad. God, this place stinks. At least it doesn't look like there's any animatronics here. FNAF 3 is the greenest of the FNAF games, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much. Thank you for watching. Subscribe. Thank you. Thank you. Lime lighting with damp walls. Withered relics decorate its halls, and the building seems as though it's gonna collapse in on itself at any moment. Turning the Fazbear brand into a horror attraction was one of the most genius decisions I've ever seen in horror, and the building itself absolutely echoes this sentiment. FNAF 1's building felt uncanny. FNAF 2's had a sterile corporate environment, but FNAF 3 completely embraced the genre it's set in. It brings back the tight corridors from the first game and presents its players with a very limited view, leaving our imaginations to do a lot of the work, as the camera themselves are very poor quality. I can't see anything on this goddamn camera. Oh hey! As iconic as the first buildings are, FNAF 3's location feels like its own character that is trying to scare me. The previous FNAF settings build it up to be almost a celebration of the franchise's history so far. Props from both buildings plastered in every corner, bringing their own auras of fear as its unnatural hue showers our vision. Just like its main antagonist, this horror attraction is an amalgamation of why this franchise succeeded in the first place. Off-putting visuals juxtaposed with childlike decor. It is easily my favorite FNAF setting so far. FNAF has always featured a wide cast of creepy and scary characters. On top of the characters being menacing,
got you there. Did you get scared?
Each gameplay mechanic an animatronic employed would be complemented by the others, creating a well-balanced trial of tasks.
Don't fuck yourself.
Dude, you— But this time around, it was all a one-man show.
Fuck you, Springtrap!
Game by game, Scott was mastering his craft on how he could compose the perfect antagonist. All the practice he got in creating the first few designs, all the way to the toy animatronics, made Scott's creative mind a true palace of how horror should look. Before saying anything about this game, I feel it would be wrong if we didn't talk about the star himself. Springtrap is the magnum opus of Scott's work. I said it before, and I'll say it again. This shit is way better than this shit. I've been sitting at my desk for hours looking for the right words to express my thoughts. I almost find myself speechless looking at him. A man and a machine melded together as a horrible amalgamation of flesh and metal. His mere existence is wrong, and the pain he must feel in every waking moment sends shudders down my spine. Compared to the rest of the animatronics, he is by far the most alive, which I feel is sort of ironic. He's a literal walking corpse. He's the boogeyman in a fursuit. All sorts of levels of wrong going on there. The first few games placed a simple challenge before me and asked me to beat it to the best of my abilities. Night after night, the difficulty would ramp up, but I was never questioning, what should I do? Maybe I'm dumb, or maybe this is how many other people felt when first playing FNAF 3, but I was plopped into my new office, and I was at a total loss on how to play. But hour by hour, I began learning that I was in a life or death game of cat and mouse. A creature of the night was roaming my halls, searching, hunting for me. In order to keep Springtrap away from us, we'd have to play audio throughout the building to lure him away. I was forced to put my listening ears on, as any audio cue of Springtrap's movements was vital for my survival.
I gotta learn more. Springtrap, it's me, an innocent child. Please come kill me. Yes, Springtrap, just walk through this portal and kill me. I am an innocent child who wants to die.
If he tried to make his way in a vent, I'd have to race to seal them on him, as they were usually express lanes to my office. I'd be forced to frantically search the cameras in order to keep tabs on my own personal Grim Reaper. If he manages to spot me, the pressure he applies goes up by tenfold. And not only is Springtrap trying to kill us, but every tool we are given is working against us. The low budget of the building causes things to malfunction left and right, forcing me to divert my attention to fix them. These issues would lead to my cameras disabling, audio system failing, and the building's ventilation going absolutely haywire.
Now why should I give a damn about-
Without the audio system, I couldn't lure Springtrap away. Without the cameras, I couldn't track down where he was. And without the ventilation-
Hey Liam, guess what?
What?
Chicken butt.
No!
Not fixing the ventilation makes us start hallucinating, and we are assaulted by an array of phantom animatronics, causing an array of other issues. Sometimes they even spawn in your cameras, and if you don't look away quick enough, you'll just be punished. The phantoms have the audacity to mess up your systems and trigger alarms to go off, attracting Springtrap himself. Unfortunately, fixing these issues would force us to switch off the camera, leaving Springtrap unattended. The stress I felt whenever my eyes were glued to the cams was almost intoxicating, as it was making adrenaline run through my veins. For me, FNAF 3 was easily the most interactive game, and it felt as though I was playing a game of chess with my killer. Reaching 6 a.m. in the past was always the goal, but this time around, I truly felt like I earned it, as I was making the decisions and the plays that brought me here. I wasn't just reacting, but I was making my own moves to bring me to the finish line.
Hi.
You know what? I'm getting out of here. I'm done with this shit. What are you looking at, ugly?
Yeah, let's blow this popsicle stand. This is gonna be good.
Goodbye, Fazbear Fright. Huh?
Bittersweet, but fitting.
What the? Please, please leave me alone.
That was easier.
Go away, go away.
Just fucking, I'll make a fucking portal. Just fucking
fuck out of here, man. I'm serious. Like, this is fucking... Holy shit.
You don't
man.
Have to tell me twice. Oh, oh, where the hell am I now?
You.
Who the hell are you?
Well, I'm your old pal, Snugglebottom.
No, you're not!
Yeah, I am. Well, please, follow me. I'll explain everything you need to know, old friend.
I hope I get some answers.
Yeah, yeah, I should've forgotten.
So, what the hell was Springtrap?
Before I answer any questions, let me take you to my office. By the way, if you play Destiny?
Fuck you.
You know, I knew a green ghost like you once.
Mm-hmm.
He was in one of my favorite films when I was a youngster like yourself.
Mm.
Maybe you two would know each other. His name was Slinker or Sludge.
I always come back.
Sticky, I don't know how he found us. I'll make enough for portal. Now run. Run like the wind.
I need to get out of here. Hey, give me your car.
Hey, you're that YouTuber Sticky, right?
Shut up. What the hell was that?
You will not be spared.
Happy Fazbear birthday! Pizza, games, and cakes! Open all your presents until your tummy...
Alright, bunny boy. Square up.
Got you!
Gotcha! Now it's time for your reign of terror to go sky high! So sorry about that. Now we can finally talk in peace.
What the hell was that?
Somebody is in a bit of a mood. I understand your frustration. Springtrap is a little bit of a rascal, huh?
He chased me out of the building! None of them have done that before!
Feisty thing. Now it is my belief that you have a lot of questions on what you just experienced. The truth behind your time at Fazbear's Frights.
Yeah! I think I deserve some answers!
Can you please lower your voice?
Whatever, bitch.
Listen, I can't tell you much about Springtrap, but he's been with us for a long time. He's not quite like the others. He's much more malicious. He's done things that make people like you and me toss and turn in their sleep. His name is William Afton. He lured the children into his trap, killing with no remorse all they laid their trust in his hands. I thought he had died long ago, when his own creation locked him in a cocoon of agony. But somehow he's alive.
You're telling me William Afton started this whole mess? The man behind the slaughter?
Yes, but you're safe now. It seems after that whole fiasco, we finally laid him to rest. He will never come back. Your journey ends here now. I'm sorry for the torment that this must have caused you, but the story has come to conclusion. I'm glad to say that you may go home.
It's over? I can leave? Thank you, Snugglebottom! Thank you, thank you! Woohoo! Thank God it's over. Home, sweet home. Oh, and a beautiful dinner to fill up my empty belly.
2 seconds later.
What a fulfilling meal. Time for this green ghost to hit the hay.
Passing you.
Every game breaks the mold on the series' previous conventions, but this entry is an entirely new level. The formula and gameplay is so contorted, the experience itself feels like some sick science experiment gone wrong, or maybe terribly right. When I first sat down and looked at the visuals for this game, it came off as horribly corny. I sat on a call with my friend who showed me the teasers Scott released before I played the game, and I was put off so badly by how edgy the characters looked. Teeth spiky, claws pointed, and their eyes piercing. I loved all the previous designs of the animatronics because of how grounded they were and their ability to present you with a strong horror concept while also looking like a plausible childhood mascot. Seeing this new presentation felt like Scott forgot what made the animatronics scary in the first place. Regardless of my suspicions, I booted up the game needing to know the direction FNAF 4 was going to. Would it mimic its predecessors by sticking to the formula, or will it try to evolve the series by taking its own unique steps? Opening my eyes, the flashlight flickered itself to life, and my eyes laid themselves onto a child's room. There were toys scattered across the floor, deep blue carpet stretching to each corner of the room, and a door placed on either end. Every game before, I was gifted with an office and tools to defend myself from the creatures of the night. This time I sat in a place so personal and so vulnerable, my fear carried on even after I closed the game, as nowhere felt safe. There was no phone guy, no cameras, and no mask to hide behind. Attempting to grasp my environment was a blur. My light shunned down each hall, lighting up the cabinets, picture frames, and decor. The house is littered with scattered noises trickling down its halls, whispering into your ears like some kind of ghost.
Hey, can you hear me?
The hairs on my skin rise as the feeling of being watched bathes me like moonlight. My curiosity is too much. The sensation of being watched is cold and dares me to investigate.
Z
For me, FNAF's strongest tool of horror has always been its sound design. Even when it takes a back seat, Scott made sure they played a vital yet subtle role in guiding us to that sweet, sweet 6 a.m.
Let's go!
FNAF 4 places so much importance on sound this time around that it became an entire game mechanic. I was asked to listen for monsters creeping outside my room. Their shuffling in my halls was nails on a chalkboard every time I heard them.
I am in a nest of Jews. They have cleverly shifted their shapes. One of them has taken the form of a little old woman.
Sound has become life or death. Screams from behind your back ward off the Freddles with your blinding light. If they stay there too long, you'll pay. Hear a monster trudging through your home. Listen carefully for where it's coming from. When you go to meet it at the door, listen and listen close. No breathing? Shine the light. If you hear and feel their breath, close the door and keep it shut. Open too early? What makes FNAF 4 so powerfully eerie is knowing the animatronic rests inches from your face. As your sound is turned up to listen to FNAF 4's subtle cues, the inevitable jump scare hits so much harder. The threats begin piling up, your left, your right, behind you, even your bedroom closet. Each task asks you to sacrifice some precious time, leaving the other threats to make their moves. FNAF 4 is a juggling act of horror, and it handles its charade with nothing but perfection.
There I am, Gary, there I am!
Scott understood that FNAF 4 was going to be one of the more challenging titles in the series, so in between each night, we were given a chance to make our playthrough just a bit easier. We are in a new part of the house. When I built the courage to turn on the light, I was greeted with a miniature springtrap atop his high chair throne. Whenever the light was off, he would creep towards us, and to keep him at bay, we need to shine the light down onto his wicked body. The objective of the game forces us to listen as he creeps closer and closer. Once he finally makes it right in front of us, you flick the light on him, freezing him in place. But if it's done too late...
This is my mother. She oldest woman in the whole of Kusek. She is a 43. I love her.
As I progressed night to night, the formula would get harder and harder, allowing for fewer and fewer mistakes. When I finally made it to night 5, I was confident I could conquer it like every night before, checking my halls from left to right, waiting for them to make their move. Night 5 was the ultimate test of the skills I was forced to master. This terrible creature was running back and forth and left and right, behind me, sitting on the bed, or crawling into my own closet. It would push everything I learned so far to the absolute limits, and its distorted laughter was salt in the wound to my panic.
No, dude!
From beginning to end, FNAF 4 showed me that it can and will stand shoulder to shoulder with hundreds of other highly praised horror titles. FNAF 4 was a brilliant experiment on how the series could consistently scare its players and build on the franchise's iconic Five Night formula. Not only did it provide what I thought was easily the best game, making the previous three pale in comparison, after every night, I was treated to another chapter in this game's story. A child deathly afraid of the Fredbear Diner animatronics. Day in and day out, he would cry and cry and cry. His brother tormented him, further isolating his little brother until one day they took it too far.
Bonnie. Freddy, you know. Chica, please.
What a terrible nightmare. I gotta go clear my head. hell? I was just downtown and now I'm... Huh.
You're having nightmares,
Nightmares? Wait, are you another Snugglebot?
I said, are you having nightmares?
Yeah? Do you know what they mean?
It never ends. Those dreams, those nightmares, they aren't yours.
What do you mean, they aren't mine?
Sticky, listen to me. I need you to do me a favor. There's this old place I know. I want you to check it out and see if there's a few things a friend of mine left behind. Can you do that for me?
If I do, will this all be over?
I don't know. It's by his place. You'll need to take the elevator down. Good luck, Sticky.
What is this place? I don't have a good feeling about this.
You can now open the elevator using that bright red and obvious button.
Sister Location's lore was one of the most informative, interesting, and strongest displays of storytelling Scott Cawthon has given us with the series so far. Listening to all of its dialogue, learning its secrets, and really digesting the story it wanted to tell was one of the most unique experiences I've had with Five Nights at Freddy's. Impressive voice acting helped immerse me into its much heavier emphasis on telling a story.
You are now in the primary control module. It's actually a crawl space between-
And I was genuinely impressed with all of the performances. We get to hear William for the first time, arguably the most important person in lore. And the first time he spoke, his voice was bone-chilling.
She can dance. She can sing.
He was no longer just a name or some low-quality sprite to me. He had a voice. He sounded cold, callous, calculated, and British. All of this sounds great and makes a strong case for itself to be one of, if not the best FNAF game, but all of this gold was nearly overshadowed for me by how astonishingly similar the gameplay was to the feeling of sponge bathing an elderly person.
Are you fucking serious?
Unlike the past FNAF games, each passing night had its own unique gameplay loop, making every night its own individual experience. On paper, I really do love this idea, as it would make the game incredibly refreshing and hold plenty of replay value, but I was wrong. Replaying this game is a slog. I don't think by any sense of the word, Sister Location is bad.
This game fucking sucks.
But if I compare it to the previous games, it becomes apparent how much of a black sheep this game is to the franchise.
You can now open the elevator.
Almost every night, we will be starting off in this very elevator. I actually really like this place and its aesthetic. It serves as a really nice calm before the storm as we descend into the Sister Location. No, I don't know why I did that. In this elevator, we are first introduced to the hand unit.
Your pay has been decreased by a substantial amount.
Oh, the hand unit was actually a pretty funny addition, and he had plenty of charm with my first handful of interactions with him.
You've earned your 1 week bonus, which will be given to you in the form of a delightful gift basket. The cost of which will be taken out of your next paycheck.
I really enjoyed the scummy corporate direction of humor, and I do give big props to the voice actor for nailing his job.
Exotic Butters.
Even though I found the hand unit mostly likable, in my opinion, there were many moments where Scott tried a little too hard to make the hand unit a comedic character. Some jokes fell flat, and instead of laughing at the comedic relief, kinda just left me feeling awkward. The first night is essentially just a long introduction as to what the sister location is, and the chores it wants us to complete. Like zapping animatronics if they're being too shy. After we use our lightning powers to zap every animatronic in the building, the first night's over. And now, we get to mosey on home and eat some popcorn.
Sure glad they ate my wheel.
Now we're back in the elevator, and while we're on our way down, we get some more hand unit banter.
Welcome back for another night of intellectual stimulation.
But this time he's an angsty teen, because, sure.
The elevator stopped. You know the routine. You can get out now, or whatever.
He does give us interesting information, though.
A dead body was found in this vent once.
Fun. Giving Ballora a shock kicks off the beginning of weird shit, and Funtime Foxy even more so.
Let's zap her. That should be fun.
Crawling into the next room, our task with Circus Baby goes even worse.
Commencing system restart.
Oh man.
So now I'm under a desk, playing the most annoying game of tug of war I'd ever experienced. Like, fuck off! Once we finish this, Baby tells us we must go through Ballora's gallery slowly and quietly. In order to manually reset the power. If we choose to move through it quickly, walking through Ballora's gallery is the least suspenseful thing and most boring shit I have ever experienced. There is legitimately no challenge when you understand what to do. Just walk slowly. Right before I fell asleep, I finally made it to the other side. Once we make it to the breaker room, we actually get an entertaining and suspenseful minigame with a new animatronic, Funtime Freddy.
You think he's a cooler fucking shotgun,
I was actually stressed the fuck out trying to restart the systems while this actual mental patient of an animatronic is being a lunatic in the background.
What a party pooper!
It's a classic balance of doing the thing I need to do brings danger closer to me. An old formula, but one that will never get old. And Funtime Freddy's design is so sick!
Yeah!
I love the added touch of Bonnie as a hand puppet. I'm actually just a really big fan of both of the Funtime designs. I love their color schemes, how playful they look, and their simultaneously futuristic yet very plausible look. Once the power is reset, we're free to go. Usual tasks are performed, but there isn't a trace of Funtime Foxy. Hand Unit encourages us to make our way through his auditorium, insisting everything is still in order. Walking through Funtime Auditorium was nothing special, simply a slightly different version of maneuvering through Ballora's gallery. There is nothing necessarily wrong with these moments in Sister Location.
Kill them.
But for me personally, they are such a snooze to get through. This was just a big problem I had with Sister Location, period, as the gameplay was severely boring. The lore was the only thing keeping me playing from night to night, because the plot and narrative were genuinely interesting. The walkthrough Funtime Auditorium drags us into one of the game's actual biggest highlights. Up close and personal, we perform a very intense repair on Funtime Freddy. This is something Sister Location actually repeats once more, and both times this segment is done, I found them to be super fun and super strong gameplay sections.
SpongeBob, look!
It is so unnerving to be this close to an animatronic. It feels like they could wake up any moment and pounce on us. Seeing their faces pop open in their dormant states left me with goosebumps. Playing these sections the first time was super scary, and I love that. But once we finish up our repairs, we get to go back home.
It's funny because you think you're going to heaven.
No! No! What the fuck?
We're stuck. A spring lock suit slowly ticks away as we desperately scramble to keep it together. This night was agony. It was one of the most frustrating, unfun, butt-blasting, shit, fuck, okay, headache-inducing,
welcome to Papa,
Are you fucking serious?
No!
Slimy turd of a gameplay section I've ever played in any game ever.
No!
We are forced to sit still and constantly keep these spring locks in check before they pop and instantly kill us in gruesome fashion.
Make him!
There's an absurd amount of them and they're all ticking down at the same time. And if even one of them fails, it's over.
No!
All the while this is happening, we have these small ballerina assholes crawling up the sides trying to set the locks off themselves. To get the ballerinas off, we have to shake them off, which in turn would make all the locks loosen up even more, and then it's a whole fucking thing and I just hate it! This entire night did nothing but be a pain in my asshole. It was the most dull, brainless, dopey, obtuse, stupid, moronic, ballsack-squeezing, wet pickle-eating, nut-guzzling creation that poor postured snot-cockin' ever created. Fuck you, Scott! I have no problem with difficulty in games at all. I actually really love it when a game is challenging.
It won't let me up. It won't let me up.
Oh my god!
It makes your achievements and victories feel so much more satisfactory. But this whole night is the worst type of difficulty there is. It's just hard for the sake of being hard. The gameplay isn't fun and it's just overly punishing for no good reason. So, this night sucks, and if you like it, you suck, and fuck you.
Daddy isn't watching.
We're back in the elevator for one last time. Looks like the engineers from the night before never made it out. The hand unit orders us to get up close with Baby for a repair, but our conversation is hijacked.
Great job reaching parts and service. Circus Baby has been deactivated for an unknown reason. It's your job to make sure she is structurally stable and secured to the conveyor. Our technicians will take it from there.
Hello.
Baby gives us orders on how to proceed, and after our mock surgery, we leave.
Six.
The room is pitch black, and our only hope of navigating it is listening to Baby guide us through. The night can end in two ways. If we listen to Baby's direction, we enter a room with nothing but a metal machine. Behind the glass, it's watching us, an abomination of animatronics fused together. The only way we learn of its name, Ennard, is inside of the extras menu, only unlocked by beating Night 5's secret ending. She tells us her plan, their need to escape, their want for freedom. As an endoskeleton, there would be nowhere to hide, but if it looked like us, the scooper gores our insides out so we can be worn like a suit. Utterly filthy. In the other ending, we must disobey Circus Baby's directions and move the opposite direction.
Fuck you, Sticky!
Once we finally make it, we enter a room. Cameras set up in familiar places, hinting as to where we are. Sister Location's ultimate challenge starts here. We are locked in the building until 6 a.m., a classic return of the FNAF gameplay with our biggest test, Ennard. It taunts us with its innocent whispers as it claws its way to our office. This secret night deserves utter praise for its horror. Ennard is one of the most unnerving animatronic designs I've ever seen, and having such a head-on encounter makes it all the more terrifying. But here's the catch. If you die... Fuck you, Scott. If you die once, you are forced to go through all sorts of tedious misery just so you can have another crack at this difficult challenge.
Let's fucking go!
It feels horrifically absurd that we don't get some sort of checkpoint after entering the room. I used to think beating it was worth it because we would get this shitty cutscene of Ennard in our house after he followed us home, but it's not worth it. The ending is the exact same, except this one, I have to fight tooth and nail to see this robot shit crawl into my living room. I mean, this game just sucks actual nuts. Cool lore, ass gameplay. I'm gonna go play something else. Yo, where are you guys at?
Oh, Kaze! Toy robot!
Oh, jeez, oh, jeez, oh, jeez. Ennard just won't leave me alone. I wish there was a portal so I could leave. Oh,
Okay.
Oh man, where'd he go?
Whew. I'm out.
Huh. Guess I'm going in. Do not touch. Okay. Snugglebottom? Where the hell was that?
Do you realize how much of a tone you always come at me with?
Now come with me!
Okay, jeez. Your voice sounds different when you're angry. Sorry, man, I just... Oh, wow, you're different again. How does that...
Different?
Yeah, like...
No, I don't think so.
Well, I mean...
No.
Okay.
Well, that's what I thought.
What are you talking about? That's what I thought. I didn't...
So you found Williams at the London God Circus?
Well... You sent me there. What the hell even was that place?
Well, a while back, William put it away with Fazbear Entertainment, but he wanted to keep up his newfound hobby, so he made his own little company, After Robotics.
Neat name.
Not right now, I'm talking.
Oh.
So William made these brand new animatronics for his new company, the Fun Times, and he'd store them underground in the
sister location.
I didn't even say it like that, come on.
You totally did.
Whatever.
Anyways, he'd use his new creations to surprise, surprise, kill kids! Except, oops, his daughter got killed by one of the animatronics he made. Huge bummer.
Oh, wow.
Wow, for sure. Really dark stuff, I know. So, what do you think?
I think months of my life have been spent enduring this nightmare, and I want to go home. If I even have a home, or a job, or anything, I probably lost my job and my home and everything. What am I going to do, Snugglebottom? I'm broke.
I can get you a job.
Wait, really?
Yeah, of course.
Does it pay well?
It sure does.
Well, I guess that makes it better. Wow, I actually really appreciate this. Thanks, Snugglebottom.
I'll teleport you with my new little interview buddy.
Okay, guess I'm on my way. Well, I guess this is the place. Hello? Hello? Well, at least there's no animatronics here.
Five Nights at Freddy's Pizza Simulator. Now, this game was a curveball. I mean, I didn't even think it was a mainline game when I first opened it up.
What the fuck is this?
The little arcade minigame in the beginning definitely helped mask what this game truly was, but my original perception of Pizza Sim was almost immediately shattered in an instant. This game was truly phenomenal and truly stands out to me as one of the better FNAF titles I've played so far.
Document results.
Pizza Sim does so many things right for me that I couldn't help but have a smile on my face the whole time I was playing.
Help you?
Well, almost the whole time.
Oh my god!
The gameplay of Pizzeria Sim is divided into three fantastic sections each night. Firstly, a Pizzeria Sim.
Because I'm all out of money!
A much more traditional FNAF experience with a twist, and a brand new salvaging segment, my personal favorite. The Pizzeria Sim is exactly what it sounds like. We get to create our very own Fazbear Pizzeria. We get to buy all sorts of attractions, animatronics, and minigames to play.
Help me please get up.
Some of these items also hold plenty of lore significance. From my understanding, it's to a varying degree. I really enjoyed these cute little moments between the nights, and could genuinely see myself sinking a few hours into a game like this without all the freaky horror stuff. The designs were cute, imaginative, and even dangerous. Try avoiding getting your hands on the more risky attractions, as lawsuits really do drain your soul. When you think of a traditional night in FNAF, what does your mind immediately go to? Keeping animatronics away, maybe it's saving your power, or checking up on the cameras. But to me, the most significant thing I would think of is making it to 6 a.m.
Go!
Let's
go!
What?
You
What?
But Pizza Sim takes a much cooler approach to conquering the night, which I believe majorly enhanced my experience. Instead of keeping us in our office for a set amount of time, Pizza Sim tells us we only get to leave when we finish all of our little chores. We must order supplies to help keep our pizzeria afloat. Remember, we are the manager after all. Since we are very broke, our office also has air conditioning issues, forcing us to keep a fan on, otherwise we overheat.
Can I take the money?
While we're trying to get through our duties, we can be interrupted by troublesome ads hindering our progress. Where the hell did these ads even come from?
$250? Yeah, I'll take it.
Now all of this doesn't sound bad, until you realize how loud everything you're doing is. And like it or not, old friends of ours are coming in for a visit. Suddenly, Pizzeria Sim goes from being a boring office job into a fight for your survival. The giant holes on either end of your office aren't doing you any favors either. As bad as this sounds, we can defend ourselves. We are equipped with a motion detector to watch the animatronics every move, and also an audio player to lure them away from our office. Now on paper, this may not sound as stressful as I'm making it out to be, but when you're in that office and animatronics are listening to you watch an A&W app—
Guess how much that coffee is right now?
Shit hits a little different.
What is this, Sprite?
Now, the salvaging sections are quite simple, yet are my absolute favorite segments throughout the game. I think the overall vibe and visuals of these segments are what contribute to me liking it so much.
Ew, ew, ew.
Outside the alley, we have been getting our grubby little fingers on broken down animatronics to make some extra bucks. Before we're sure they can be a part of our small business, we need to do a standard checkup to make sure they're all good to go.
Yeah, you could trust me.
We have a little checklist to write up on, but ultimately, whatever we put down doesn't matter. While we do this, the animatronic will slowly begin to react and move whenever exposed to the audio prompts.
Begin audio prompt in 3, 2, 1.
Name a woman.
What?
Name a woman.
What?
If the animatronic ends up getting too handsy, then we can give them a generous shock to back them up. Now, using too many shocks can and will affect the animatronic's value. Also, whoever composed the music for this game is in dire need of a serious raise because— Now, if you thought the gameplay was already good enough, you are not ready for the absolute hamburger of lore this game provides us. There are so many little details, from arcade minigames, masked identities, old faces, and new friends. But Pizzeria Simulator's biggest achievement wasn't only adding incredibly interesting lore to the Five Nights at Freddy's story, it was ending it.
Connection terminated.
You see, everything we've played through? It was a carefully laid trap, luring each and every remaining animatronic to our pizzeria. Henry Emily, founder of Fazbear Entertainment, business partner of William Afton, father of the puppet, and the man who brought us all together. Truth is, the game was rigged from the start. Shit, shit, shit! Why is it taking so long to print?
What's that smell?
Oh! You're burning too. Is this whole place on fire? I gotta get out of here!
Shit, 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 shit.
Get this thing out of my way. I gotta get out. I gotta get out. I gotta get out of here. I gotta get out. Okay, Sticky. Okay, Sticky. Focus, focus, focus. We can get out of here. We can get out of here. Oh my god! What is that? What is that? Yeah, let's go, let's go, let's go.
Bonnie? Jesus, every time.
Okay, whatever, I gotta go. Jesus, where's the exit? Where is the exit? No, 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 are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? Henry?
Yes, and no. You'll be much better by another name. Snugglebottom.
Snugglebottom, you conniving bastard. Let me out of here now. Let me out. Snugglebottom, let me out.
Sorry, son. I have to. I let you out, they might get out too.
So what was the point? Showing me all of that? Everything you put me through? Was it all for this? To burn me alive with these things? Open this door. Snugglebottom, open this door now!
I thought if I showed you everything, leading up to this moment, you'd understand. It's for the greater good, kiddo.
Snugglebottom, no. Snugglebottom, don't leave me here. Snuggle, no. Snuggle, don't leave me here. Snuggle!
Now,
Ultimate Custom Night is a game I won't be dwelling on for too long. It's a very fun little bonus title for fans of the series, and I think Scott did a really good job making this little love letter for the fans. You can play any night you want against any animatronic you want. Each and every character from the entire series makes an appearance, and it was such a cool feeling seeing them side by side. There are some quirks to it, like how bad a lot of the animations look, in my opinion, but overall I found it to be a very charming game. The real meat and potatoes Yusion offers, though, is how it somehow fits itself into the lore. Now, there are several little tidbits that elaborate on the lore, and also fun nods to the franchise's past. For a while, I was confused on how a game with 50 animatronics from several different parts in the timeline, some real and some fake, could fit into the story. Eventually, I would sit down and watch some videos to help wrap my head around on what Yusion meant to the greater Five Nights at Freddy's story, and what I'm about to say is a heavily abbreviated explanation from a fellow YouTuber, Saganhawks, I'm not sure how to pronounce it, but he makes much better videos than me, and you should definitely go subscribe to his channel and watch his videos for yourself. Thank you to Saganhawks. I don't know him, but seems like a really cool guy, and you guys should go subscribe. So, after Pizza Sim, every single person important to the lore who was still alive was burnt to death and sent to the afterlife. The vengeful spirit, filled with rage after being murdered by William, halts William's entry to hell as the spirit wants to torture William himself. Or the spirit meets William in hell, I'm not too certain. So, William is forced to die by the hands of his own creations for eternity, death after death after death. Now, that would be where the story would end if it wasn't for this small minigame involving a character Old Man Consequences. Who is Old Man Consequences? I don't necessarily know. From my understanding, he is a part of a game called FNAF World, which I unfortunately didn't play. Maybe he's an angel? I don't know. During this minigame, it appears our perspective switches from William Afton to the vengeful spirit. Old Man Consequences asks us to sit calmly and rest our soul and leave the demons to his demons. Upon entering the water, the game will crash. To me, this implies that the vengeful spirit finally lets go of their hate and moves on, ending the torture and the cycle. Now, I'm not necessarily sure if this ending is canon. It could just be a suggestion of what could happen if the spirit lets go. So either William is being tortured for eternity by the vengeful spirit, or eventually the spirit moves on. I don't know for sure. Now that was Ultimate Custom Night. There's not much else to say. The Five Nights at Freddy's franchise was one of the most spectacular experiences I have ever had the pleasure to witness. From scares to fantastic storytelling, it was a real bittersweet feeling seeing it all end. Part of me wishes I could turn back time and see it all from the start, to grow up alongside it like so many others. Part of me is grateful I experienced it at all. Scott Coffin, thank you for everything. Five Nights at Freddy's will be something that will stick with me for the rest of my days, and always have a special place in my heart. Good night, Internet. Stay sticky.
I'm stuck in hell with you?
Hey, why don't we all calm down? Maybe we can try and get out of this together, huh?
No, back up, William. You're a fucking child serial killer. You know you deserve this, right? If it wasn't for you, none of this would have happened. You started everything.
Hurtful.
I can't believe this. We're dead. We're dead. Oh my god, we're dead. We're dead. We're dead, we're dead.
Looks like we got friends too.
I have to get out of here, I have to. Please, God, hear me. Please, let me out. Please, please, please.
Who the hell are you? God.
No, William. Not God. I am Steel Wool.
Listen, man, whoever you are, please just get me out of here. I don't deserve this. I don't!
I have come with an offer. I'll let you out of this into a prison on one condition. You will help me revive the FNAF franchise.
What? No! What do you mean, revive? It ended perfectly! There's nothing left to say, there's nothing left to do!
Not on my watch, Sticky. Now you have one choice. Come with me, or stay here forever.
Do I get to come too?
Shut up! I won't! I can't!
You turn your back on your last chance at living?
Fine. I'll come with you.
Good choice, my friend. Good choice.
This game is fucking terrible.